Hey guys, welcome to another episode of Mike Explores. I hope you're all doing all right in the quarantine world. And today we're going to talk about a very important topic. And that topic is, how can you and I, how can we all help out in this time of crisis here in Bangkok? And for that matter, we're going to talk to Adam Sharp. He's one of the co-initiators of COVID Relief Bangkok. And he's got a lot of inspiring things to tell us. So let's jump right in.
This is Adam Sharp, advocate, educator, social innovator, with more doctor titles than Kim Kardashian got handbags. From the UN to Asia Pacific Youth Exchange, Meta Future to 20th Century Workshops and Young Creators UK, if he's not empowering young people, he's guiding great organizations towards a sustainable future for us all. Now he's again in the pole position for yet another awesome initiative called COVID Relief Bangkok.
Adam, I'm very happy to have you here on Zoom and be talking to you. I've known you for quite some time now. I think it goes back 7 years, 2013, 2012 maybe, you know, during the flood reliefs when you were still working with MTV Exit. Ever since, you've always been on my radar when it comes to topics like sustainability, social innovation, and youth empowerment and all these. So thanks for having been an inspiration throughout all these years. And obviously now in this time of crisis, who other than you, you know, is stepping up the game again, and you have started something called COVID Relief Bangkok. And so today, yeah, I'm tuning in with you to see what COVID Relief Bangkok is about. What do you guys do and why did you start it?
Awesome. Well, yeah, thanks for giving me the chance to speak to you, Michael. And again, you know, your work over the years has been an inspiration to many of us, I'm sure. Yeah, I should say right off the bat that I didn't start COVID Relief. It's really been a coalition of organizations who are all eager to do something in a time where I think many of us felt a bit powerless alone. You know, it was only a couple of weeks ago that I was sort of at home thinking about being locked down, figuring out what to do. And I saw a friend of mine on social media post a box of instant noodles on Facebook and said, I'm just handing these out to, you know, the local builders, you know, who really need some food. And I messaged him. I said, man, yeah, that's good of you to at least be trying to do something. And it just sparked a little seed of an idea, and I messaged Sax. I don't know if you know Sax, but he's the founder of City Foundation and also runs Broccoli Revolution, a couple of other sort of social enterprises. And I messaged him and said, dude, I know you're doing something. What's happening? What's going on? And he said, you're a mind reader. I'm speaking to this organization, that organization. I need some help. And I said, right, I'm in. And that feels like months ago now. Months. Wow. It's only been a couple of weeks.
Right.
So yeah, it's a real coalition.
Okay. So the founder of Broccoli Revolution, who else is involved in this?
So I think some of the initial conversations, we started working with Urban Studies Lab. Mm-hmm. And they provide the sort of data mapping that allows us to identify those communities most at risk in Bangkok. They go by age and income. Mm-hmm. To say these are the most at risk of COVID-19. Mm-hmm. So they help us on strategy. Then there's the Thai Health Volunteers Association. Now they have health centers in districts all over Bangkok.
Super.
And they are really helping to manage the distribution side. So we help build the strategy, we organize the campaign, and that's really a big part of my role is how do we mobilize, how do we capture the public attention and imagination, how do we raise funds, how do we get the essential items together, and then you've got to work with those local civil society partners who have the relationships at the local level to try and distribute them safely. So this coalition is growing. We now have Brand Think on board, which is a huge advertising giant in Thailand who are now on board to start creating content and start building the campaign up, potentially doing some celebrity activism and campaigns. And I might be missing one. And of course, Social Giver. So mm-hmm. Social Giver joined us as a partner. That's our donation platform. They cover all the credit card fees. So every single cent that gets donated to us comes direct to us. and they keep us accountable. So this is what I mean by a coalition. This is a bunch of organizations that all really need to work together in order to take on what is a Amazing. Monumental challenge, yeah. which is how do you get the most, how essential items to people who need them the most in the safest way possible. And we're learning how to do that every day. So it's a real team effort.
Amazing, man. Amazing. This really, you know, gets me gets the energy up. And that's sometimes, you know, when we feel so desperate and, you know, powerless that communicating and whooping things up and then seeing also the effects is tremendously positive for our psyche and for, you know, like the whole vibe and energy. So, yeah, thank you very much for sharing this. And what's the situation on the ground at the moment and how do you see it evolving over the coming weeks?
So the situation right now in some communities is pretty desperate, meaning there's, say, for example, for some of our local partners, there's a real lack of equipment, protective gear, okay. safety gear. So the ability to actually respond to a crisis like this and help people without quickly becoming part of the problem is very challenging. And when I say becoming part of the problem, I mean distributing goods and services to people who need them the most, but at the same time knowing that you're not unintentionally spreading the disease and making the situation worse. And so our local partners, we're doing a lot of work with them to make sure that they have the masks that they need, the gloves that they need, the face shields that they need, so that they're actually distributing in a safe way. Mm-hmm. And it's like this behavior is very new. You know, right. we're all learning and figuring out how to do it. You know, even collecting donations, making sure everything's sanitized, right. making sure we have volunteers come in groups, not all at the same time, and they keep a 2 meter distance apart. You know, exactly. these things we're learning how to do on the fly. So the situation right now is really about building the capacity of all organizations that we're working with. And in some communities, like for example, Samedam, I don't know if you know where Samedam sub-district is, it's the other side of the river, sort of southwest, like southwest, so it's like a suburb of Bangkok, southwest. Mm-hmm. They have a very high density of elderly and low-income households there.
Okay.
And very high density. So we've identified about 2,800 households that need support. And so the situation right now is we need to raise enough funds and gather enough donations to support those households mm-hmm. over the next month. We distribute the essential items, mask, hand sanitizer, soaps, 5 kilo bag of rice, canned fish, soy milk. That makes up a pack and it costs approximately 300 baht. So to support 3,000 families, we need to raise 900,000 baht. And I'm happy to say, because of the amazing support of our community who mobilized like that very quickly in the space of a couple of weeks, we've raised just over 300,000 baht and we have a compound with a lot of donations in it ready to go. So there's that sort of bigger sort of campaign that's really scaling now. We already did a distribution to 170 households in Nanglang community. Now we're scaling up to reach thousands of families in the most at-risk districts of Bangkok. But you've got to marry that with a situation that is unpredictable and with needs that pop up on the fly. So, for example, just yesterday there was a meeting with the Thai Health Office in Nanglang community, mm-hmm. and they'd identified 20 households that were on lockdown, complete oh, wow. lockdown and quarantine, because they actually had COVID-19 positive family members in the household, so no one can leave, not even for food. Right. So there's 20 households. So today we got those donations, those packs out to those 20 households. And every week we'll be sending food and the needed supplies to those households until they're out of quarantine. So you've got the grand plan of scale, but we have to sort of adapt and be nimble to the immediate needs that communities face as this crisis and this pandemic spreads in ways, you know, that we're only just learning about. So that's the current situation. We've done very well, but we need to do more if we're going to support the most in need households across the city.
Right. Yeah. I mean, the whole logistics and coordination between all the different stakeholders is a tremendous undertaking, and you're basically doing it from the confines of your home with the laptop and the phone, and that's the great thing. I wonder what we would do without the internet, how we would cope in a situation like that. Right?
I don't know if we would. I mean, again, I'm at home managing the online campaign, but my colleagues and our founder, Sax, is at Bangkok 1899. He runs Now Cafe there. That's the donation drop-off spot. Right. So any donations of those key items I mentioned, they send to Bangkok 1899 from Tuesday to Sunday from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. So he has, you know, a volunteer team there that's all being very careful, a small team who help manage and coordinate the donations. So there's still the physical work and the graft that needs to be done to actually physically get donations out there. But yeah, I mean, it's the internet that has allowed us to build these partnerships very quickly and mobilize the kind of support that we have. And, you know, it's been really uplifting. The Facebook group grew to like 1,500 members, like in just a few days. I mean, just the response was extraordinary. And the speed of the mobilization has been very heartwarming. And now we need to see if we can scale that up to really reach the masses.
The need to be on the ground, of course, was utmost precautions is, of course, you know, like a reality that whether we go to 7-Eleven, we go to the bank, or I just went to Macro the other day. People are just like, the first thing, assistant is disinfecting your trolley. Then you get measured with the temperature, you get soap, the cashier. So, you know, Macro was very busy. There are a lot of people. So keeping the distance between all the shoppers was nearly impossible. So people are still out there, lots of them doing, you know, what they need to do in order to survive, which is buying all the essentials. So it's very difficult to get around that. And so I think that the protection, whether it's for the healthcare workers or for people that alleviate the economic impacts like you guys, is necessary. You have to have foot on the grounds, but also then, you know, applying all the measures that are necessary to keep everyone as safe as possible. My best wishes go out to all the people doing this kind of work on a voluntary basis, heads off to you guys. From your experience now working in this couple of weeks with the COVID relief, what were some of the uplifting experiences you had? Or there's some things that you know, in desperate times, I mean, you know, often it brings people together and it brings out the best in us. Is there something in particular that gives you the energy and gives you the positivity? Is there anything in that?
I think that it's amazing how this kind of situation, this kind of crisis makes things possible that weren't possible before. And, you know, one of those possibilities is this coalition of partners from such different backgrounds, you know, to be pairing BrandThink with the Thai Health Volunteers Foundation is completely nuts. You know, when would that partnership happen? You know, it's, again, we need a good crisis to get us going. And so, you know, being able to pull a coalition like this together in the space of a couple of weeks has been truly heartwarming. And I think more than that, to now start building the trust level where, you know, an organization says to us, there's 20 households that are locked down, quarantined now, we need help now. And you just drop what you're doing, you put the packs together, and you are as safe as possible, and you get the packs to them, and you knock on the door, and you step away from the door. You keep it as, and they open up, and it's and there you go, and that's it. And so to see the systems now in place, the coalition in place, the system in place, and now the ability to respond in a fast and nimble way, I think we're just learning very quickly and we're working together well. And so that's heartwarming for me.
Awesome.
to see these things build so quickly.
That's amazing. Yeah, this is something a lot, it says a lot about our ability to self-organize in these kind of times. No? But do you also see something that some shortcomings of our, you know, of the systems before in dealing with such crisis of such magnitude? Do you see any shortcomings that were revealed because of that COVID-19?
You know, I think that Thailand is probably no different to a lot of other countries that have been sort of stunned by this pandemic. And a situation like this, a crisis like this, does expose the sort of inherent vulnerabilities in all kinds of areas, right? I mean, when you look at, say, some of our civil society partners, they're chronically underfunded, and you know, they often don't have the frontline equipment that they need to do this kind of work safely. So the capacity building that needs to happen in such a short period of time to respond effectively is monumental. So I think this is the same, you know, in the UK. You know, our health service has been chronically underfunded for a decade and has been suffering, and morale has been so low. And then you get hit with a pandemic like this, and it really exposes the frailties of a system that only prioritizes the market and doesn't invest adequately in the health systems and the fundamental safety nets that society needs when the chips are really down. And so again, I don't think Thailand is any different to any other countries. I think this exposes a lot of vulnerabilities in our politics and a lot of vulnerabilities in our leaders to respond adequately. The lack of global coordination between our leaders has been, I think, pretty shocking and eye-opening for all of us. And without wanting to get too political here, you know, about the specific situation in Thailand, I think Thailand is a country that's going to get hit really hard by this, you know, with an economy that's so reliant on tourism. And you know this better than anyone. You know this better than I do at Bangkok Vanguards. You know, 11% of this economy relies on tourism. And suddenly when you click your fingers and it's gone, you know, there was an amazing picture posted by the Bangkok Post. We shared it on the Facebook group for COVID Relief. And please do join the Facebook group. People just type in COVID Relief and find the group. Mm-hmm. And it was a picture in Khao San. I saw this. It was a picture before the curfew. It must have been about 8 p.m. in Khao San of these street vendors. I think they might have been selling noodles or something. And no one on the street in Khao San, just empty street, like a scene out of Vanilla Sky. And if you see, you know, he's running through Times Square and there's no one there, you know, it's right. Like very surreal. And this vendor, I don't know whether it's her sister or her daughter, I'm not sure, but she's hugging her from behind her in this empty street. And I thought, if there was ever a symbol of the devastation economically that this situation is going to cause so many people, countries that were really reliant on tourism are going to get hit the hardest, and not just tourism, you know, other industries as well that have been hit so hard. I think the recent estimates were that, like, I think 140,000 people have signed up for unemployment benefits in Thailand over the last couple of months since the fallout of COVID-19. 140,000, and I think they're expecting 6.5 million people to be put out of work, including migrant workers, because of this crisis here in Thailand. I mean, you can't get your head around the impact, and that's, you know, the inherent vulnerabilities. And there's a certain amount of this that just can't be helped. You know, however many people saw Bill Gates a few years ago deliver a speech on the TED stage, doesn't mean that you're prepared for something like this. So it's not going to be easy for anyone. But I think we need to learn from the responding well and are able to bounce back from this situation fast. And I'm worried about Thailand, man. I'm worried about the country and the people that are going to be affected.
Yeah, same here. We still can't grasp where the journey is going to to actually take us on so many levels, socially, economically, culturally, politically, not just Thailand. I think for the whole of humanity, that's the case. It's a massive social experiment, basically, that we are experiencing right now, and we're just at the beginning. So, yeah, despite all the challenges ahead, in terms of the COVID relief, Adam, what can people do? Like, how can, like, the viewers that watch this video and I want to support, what would be some actionable steps right now?
Well, the first thing they can do is stay home and stay safe. We have a lot of the volunteers who want to help, but first and foremost, we want people to stay home and be safe and do their best not to be part of the problem. You know, you can already do something for the country by flattening the curve and staying home. So again, I know a lot of our volunteers would love to roll up their sleeves and get out there. And we're not prepared to do that for many volunteers at all, because we want to keep people safe. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, it's really easy to support COVID relief and help us grow. The easiest way is to join the Facebook group and share the Facebook group and, you know, grow that base of supporters that can really help drive the campaign forward. So that's the easiest way. The next way is to actually donate some of the materials that we need to Bangkok 1899 Cafe, Na Cafe. That's in Nang Len. And you can share with us masks, hand sanitizer, soaps, rice, canned fish that Thai people want to eat, not just your typical tuna. The kind of canned fish that Thai people want to eat. By sending those, you know, using a line man or a service like that, you don't have to come out yourself. You know, you can send that way. But the easiest way to support, if you want to put your money where your mouth is to go to the social giver and actually donate funds there, because we're going to really need that to grow if we're going to help people at scale. So that the in-hand donations are fantastic. And if we didn't have them, we wouldn't be able to respond to those 20 households yesterday, you know? So they're essential. But if we're going to reach thousands of families, then we're looking to mobilize donations. We've had some incredible volunteers, man, you know, like, one of our volunteers, Gabrielle, you know, managed to get hundreds of soaps donated from, hundreds of masks donated from friends. She's just calling people up and saying, hey, there's this amazing cause. Can you help? Would you like? And so she's been amazing. We've had others who have done donation drives in their condos. So they put a message out to their entire condominium and say, you know, drop all of the goods here at this spot, and we'll send it to COVID relief. And then literally hallways are packed every week. So there have been some super volunteers out there. So those kinds of efforts are amazing. But if you know organizations or individuals who want to help, then please point them towards the social giver, because we get all of that money, and all of that money goes direct to the people who need it. So yeah, those are the ways that you can help.
Okay, that's good information. It's very valuable, because after all the information, I feel, you know, everybody has to contribute to some way. So I think this is amazing what you guys are doing. And I hope that this will inspire more people to take action, to join this collaboration, and that you get to reach out to more families. I will talk to you specifically about what we can do from my end or my team's end later after this video. But another thing that I wanted to talk to you is the post-COVID world, the future. Mm. And how do you see Thailand in that field? I mean, like, it's difficult to say anyways, right? But do you see something like that we need to change, or the direction that we need to develop to? Have you wrapped your head around kind of like these future post-COVID scenarios? And I know that you probably have, actually, because you have a company called the 21st Century Workshops, right? So that actually deals with this fundamental question. Maybe you can tell me a little bit about that, how you see post-COVID era, and what you do is 21st century workshops.
Yeah, we've been asking ourselves this question a lot, and not just, I mean, 21st century workshop is just, it's just me, it's just my baby. But I mean, I also recently joined an organization called Meta Future, which is run by a world-renowned futurist, Dr. Sahel Inayatullah. And we specialize in really helping people and organizations create alternative futures and identify preferred futures. And I think one of the challenges we face right now is you're not seeing many articulations of what the future is going to be like from here on in and what this really means for humanity. You see some really toxic narratives on the news, you know, people saying, oh, we're fighting a war against coronavirus. That's not very helpful. You know, coronavirus isn't here to wipe out humanity. They're not, you know, they're not the Taliban. This wartime mentality probably doesn't help us. And beyond that, you know, people are very loosely, very casually saying things like, oh, the world will never be the same, you know. But I do worry that we're not articulating the future that we actually want from this. You know, there's lots of different scenarios that could come from this situation. You know, again, Sahail, my mentor, you know, he was talking me through them just the other day. And, you know, the one of the first scenarios could be this is just a pause. You know, this is but a pause. And we shut the world down for a half a year. And we come back next year faster than ever, back to normal, just as things were. We take this moment to take a deep breath, catch up with relatives and friends, and then we come back, you know, the same system as before. That's one scenario that could happen. You know, another scenario is potentially that this is not just a pause. We actually define together and articulate together the world we actually want to live in post-coronavirus, and we start addressing some of the challenges that the virus has exposed. You know, our investment in healthcare, our community networks, our priorities in life. You know, maybe this is a chance for us to really reassess and bring about the future that we want. As a worst case scenario, and that's, you know, the virus mutates and it becomes more dangerous, and we see violence break out around the world, we see civil unrest, we see the breakdown, know it, and you know, no one can predict the future, but by articulating these futures and defining what our preferred futures are, we can start at least moving in a direction that we want to, rather than simply being passengers and letting mainstream media dictate where we're going. I'd like to see more individuals and organizations articulating the future that we actually want and mapping what that future is going to take to get there. And, you know, I think I want more than a pause. You know, I want us to bring about a world that we want. I want to see more social safety nets. I'm very much in the center. I don't believe that, you know, I'm not hard left. I'm not in my early mid-20s anymore. I certainly was then. But I don't believe that the market can take care of everything. And, you know, I think we need stronger community networks, these things. This is the kind of future that I want to help bring out. More spirituality, more community, more connection, more looking out for one another. And now I just have to figure out how to get there.
Wow. Man. I feel like when I listen to you, it just like resonates so, so deeply with me. It's really, really awesome. And I'm absolutely on the same page. And I wonder, you know, to what extent you can trigger these thought processes and people to start thinking about the future. And I'm not feeling, you know, being, as you said, the passengers, but giving them the tools and also the awareness that we can be part of a co-creation process. But because it's all so messy and it's all very complex to coordinate that, there's so many requirements that you need to have the leadership aspects to it. There's so many different interests and people also exploiting the situation, you know, for their own gains. But in a sense, you know, our strong point, since we are social animals, is that we cannot live like an island. We're all dependent on each other, and we think we should use. And COVID relief is a good example of our strengths of cooperation and how we can use our strengths for the betterment of the, you know, the greater community. And I hope we can make that the spirit, right? We can make it more lasting and more sustainable post this crisis as well. Thank you very much, Adam.
Me too.
It's been, you know, really, really a pleasure catching up with you. And we'll certainly, you know, spread and spam the shit out of everyone about what COVID Relief and your gang is doing. Thank you very much, Adam, for joining this talk. And I will see you soon in person, hopefully.
Yeah, I hope so. Pleasure talking to you. Let's talk a bit more about how we can work together with Bangkok Vanguards.
Sure. Hey guys, I really hope that you enjoyed this conversation with Adam. Please support him and his coalition, COVID Relief Bangkok. All the necessary links are in the video description below. In the meantime, please stay safe, stay healthy. If you got a second, please subscribe to my YouTube channel. That would mean a lot to me. Thanks for your support. Thanks for watching. And I see you in the next episode. Thank you. Sawadee ka.